Good evening and welcome to the Planning Commission. The date is October 28th, 2013. Will everyone please rise for Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. You may be seated. The first item of tonight's agenda is the actual approval of the agenda for tonight. Does anyone have any corrections or any changes they'd like to make? If not, I'll entertain a motion.
Mr. Chairman, move to approve the agenda for tonight's meeting.
Second.
We have a motion and second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Moving on, the for the approval of the minutes for the October 14th, 2013 meeting. I know there was a couple of revisions that needed to be made. Mary, you had one, I think.
Yes, I have a correction to item B, which was the Noterman property. And I actually voted against that motion. The reason being I was in favor of going forward with the Lions Tap portion,
right.
Item B.
Okay.
And, but felt that the information was insufficient on the residential portion and that should, could be revisited when that it comes up for development.
Thank you. So noted.
Thank you.
And you're okay with that, Julie? You got those changes? Okay. Yes, sir. Go ahead.
Yeah, and I just like to, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to point out just a clarification on page 4 of the minutes, where it talks about the feasibility study for Spring Road Utilities. So it should, that last sentence should probably say something to the fact that the feasibility will be done to determine who pays for the sewer and water, and that the city would pay for the water along Flying Cloud Drive only.
Okay. Very good. We will get that in the city record too. Thank you, Mr. Does anybody else have any corrections or any changes that need to be made?
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, I just have one quick one on page 7, top of page 7. Request was somewhat confusing for commission since no concept plan was proposed for the change residential, the word residential, to non-neighborhood commercial.
Okay. Thank you very much. Any other changes? Julie, do you have any questions before we move on? Okay. Thank you very much. So with that being said, I need the approval for these minutes.
So moved.
We have a motion.
Second.
We have a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any abstentions? I don't think we have any. We have the changes. All right. Thank you very much. Next up is for the public hearings for tonight. That would be the code amendment for towers and attendance screening. This is done by the City of Eden Prairie, but I don't know who's Mike. Are you going to start us off?
I can.
Would you like to?
We just need a little bit more time to refine the ordinance. There's multiple sections in Chapter 11 that need to be adjusted, not just the section on antennas. And so that's why we're taking a little bit more time to make sure we've got all parts of the code in sync with what we're proposing.
Okay. So how would you like to proceed then?
I would recommend that this item be continued until the November 25th meeting.
Okay. All right. Does anyone have any questions with that?
No.
Okay. Is there anyone out in the audience that has any comments or concerns? Gentlemen, you got nothing?
No.
All right. Very good. With that being said, I will entertain a motion. Okay, we have a motion and a second.
Second.
Very good. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Great. Moving on. We are moving right into the planner's report. Mr. Franz, you want to take us to the beginning of that anyways with the light rail?
Actually, I should say it's the report of the Public Works Director.
Okay.
This evening, Robert.
Very
Ellis.
Good. Okay. You want to take us through that, sir?
You bet. Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. My name is Robert Ellis. I'm the Public Works Director for the City of Eden Prairie, and I'm one of the staff members that have been working with Metropolitan Council on the Southwest Light Rail portion of the project located in Eden Prairie. And I'm joined tonight with David Lindahl, our Economic Development Division Manager, and he's been very engaged in the process as well, reaching out to a lot of the local businesses and citizens that live in Eden Prairie to gain their input and insight on the design. So tonight we have a very informal presentation. We're just going to simply walk the Planning Commission through that portion of the project that's located in our community. And feel free to interrupt me with any questions, clarifications. That's what we're here tonight, is just to give you a full and complete update of what we think will be included in the municipal consent plans that will be delivered to the city, which we'll be asking the city council to vote on. So with that, I'll go ahead and dive into the presentation. And the first thing I want to explain are the key issues that we've identified along with the project office that are unique to Eden Prairie. These are issues that require just a little bit more thought process. They were a little bit more difficult, sometimes more costly, or we knew that they would generate a lot of public input and discussion. And starting on the north side of town, it was the crossing of Highway 62, how you get over the top or underneath that thoroughfare. There was also the crossing of Highway 212 and the Shady Oak Road. Moving a little bit farther south, the Golden Triangle, where exactly did that station want to be located? Then there was the environmental impacts of crossing Nine Mile Creek. That was followed by the crossing of Valley View Road that generated a lot of discussions through the draft environmental impact statement because it was planned for an at-grade crossing. Then there was the town center alignment. Where should that town center station be located? Then it was the Southwest Station. What to do? Co-locate, buy out, and it's all LRT, or just bypass it and it remains a bus station? And then finally, the last technical issue is, where does the end of line station, where should that be located? Should it be somewhere in the Mitchell Road vicinity, or should it be eliminated from the project altogether? So these are some of the details that I'll get into as I go through the alignment through Eden Prairie. One thing I like to do is always point out that this is a Metropolitan Council project. A lot of people think this is the City of Eden Prairie that's taking the lead on this, but it's really not. The city is not expected to participate financially in this project. It's really Metropolitan Council that's taking the lead on this. And they have created a number of committees to gain public input through this process. One of them is the Community Advisory Committee, of which we do have a Planning Commission member who is a part of that group. There's also the Business Advisory Committee. They created the Technical Project Advisory Committee. That is a committee that I sit on along with David Lindahl and Janet Jeremiah, and members of staff from each of the five cities in the county sit on that. And then there's the Corridor Management Committee, and they recently took action on the project here within the last couple of weeks, forwarding a recommendation to the Metropolitan Council. So those formal committees were established day one as the preliminary design got underway. Now, kind of running parallel with this Metropolitan Council design process is a step that Hennepin County has undertaken. That's the Community Works, and they're doing a transitional station area action plan. And I think what they're really trying to do is, how do you get the biggest bang out of this project? You need to have jobs, you need housing, you need economic development along the stations and alignment to make this a viable, beneficial asset to all the community. So Hennepin County has been walking hand in hand with Metropolitan Council, looking at that side of the end benefit of having this Southwest Light Rail Transit. So they're doing that through a separate process. And fortunately, these two are coming together at this very end stage, looking very much like each other, which is good, because the last thing we wanted to see is TSAP was saying, well, no, you need to make all these decisions. Metropolitan Council's disagreeing, but they're not. They're actually right on par with one another, and I guess that's a good place to be here towards the end of the project. The last couple of things I want to mention is Metropolitan Council has hosted a number of open house meetings. I think they've got 15 and counting that they've held. They've received thousands of comments from the public. So I think they've done a fairly good job of reaching out and getting that input. And then also Dave Lindahl here has actually had over 160 meetings that he's scheduled just with area businesses and citizens. So he's been very engaged with our local constituents, making sure that their voices are heard, that there is some input from them on design, because there are a number of properties that are right adjacent to the alignment and station. So Dave has done a very good job with that. And he's also been working with the local Chamber of Commerce, keeping them updated on decisions that are being made, and just making sure that they're in the loop with how things are folding out. So to dive into the specifics of the actual alignment, what I'll do is I'll start on the north side of town up by Highway 62. And I'll try to use my cursor on the computer screen to identify specific things that I'm speaking to. But one of the first key issues, technical issue, is how do you traverse Highway 62? And in the Locally preferred alignment plans that began this process through the draft environmental impact statement, it showed this as being an overpass over Highway 62. However, working with Minnetonka, who felt very strongly with the fact that they wanted to see this underground, and for them it really preserved a lot of right-of-way on their side of the border and didn't impact businesses as much, they held a strong desire to go underground versus over the top of 62. I think at the end of the day it actually cost a little bit less than going over, so we anticipate that the project office will propose that this be an underground crossing of Highway 62. And then as it gets into Eden Prairie on the UHG, the United Health Group campus, will be the first station located in our community. And UHG dedicated 4 to 5 acres of property on their campus for the sole purpose of LRT station. So there will be a surface parking lot with around 160, 190 parking stalls, I believe, and an at-grade crossing at that location. So that will be the first station within Eden Prairie. Now moving a little bit farther south down the alignment, one thing that gets a little bit tricky, these maps, the north arrow kind of changes directions to try to fit the large amount of information on here. So again, UHG is located in this area. The alignment would follow alongside Highway 62 and then it'll curve and follow Highway 212. Now in the locally preferred alignment, it actually showed a crossing of Highway 212 and then it followed the east side of 212 and then it crossed underneath Shady Oak Road. Through this evaluation process, the project office is actually recommending staying on the west side of 212 and then building one structure over the top of 212 and Shady Oak Road. And I've got a number of diagrams that'll show what that'll look like visually. This would be the first one. If you were on Highway 212 driving southbound, this first structure would be the light rail crossing over the top of 212. You can see a little bit farther in the background, that would be the Shady Oak Road Bridge that the city will actually start a project next year to reconstruct that. Driving just a little bit farther, this would be on 212 looking northbound. So this would be 212 driving north, the Shady Oak Road off-ramp. This would be the Shady Oak Road Bridge, and then in the background you can see the LRT bridge with the light rail vehicles on top of it. Another rendering, this would be on Shady Oak Road over the top of 212 looking into the Golden Triangle. This would be a rendering of the LRT bridge over Shady Oak Road.
Yeah, maybe I'll chime in here quick and just let you know that kind of back in the Prime Tech area, I don't know if you look at his cursor there, Krause Anderson owns about 5 buildings in that area, including where Lifetime Fitness used to have their corporate headquarters. There's a 5-story building, there's a 2-story building, and they have, I think, 2 1-story buildings. And they're a bit concerned about this bridge, how it starts lifting as it's moving south on 212, and how it might obstruct views from the highway to their office buildings. And we actually met with them last week, and it was one of those meetings where you're thinking you're going to meet a few people from their company, and it ended up being about 12 of their top corporate people and their attorneys. And so I think they made the point pretty clear that they've got major concerns with that bridge. So the project office staff who were at the meeting are also going to take a look at it and see whether or not there's anything they can do to mitigate some of those concerns. It's not a complete obstruction, but they're just thinking about if you're a tenant thinking about signing a lease in one of those buildings. And by the way, that real estate's kind of suffered through the recession. Many of those buildings sat vacant, actually, for quite a few years. And so they're just starting to come around. They're starting to get some leases. So they're pretty sensitive about, the project and how it might impact it. But they're concerned that if someone was going to be an anchor tenant of the building and they wanted their name up on the building, they want to make sure they can see it. So that's kind of the latest input we've gotten from those
folks.
Would they
rather have Plan A, I'm guessing, than the Plan B, than the top one?
They would rather have it on the other side of the road, so the original LPA, which then, of course, is in somebody else's backyard.
Yeah.
But I think the biggest issue for the project is that this alternative is about $10 million less than the other. Robert, is that right?
Yeah, we've looked at these options to kind of compare, contrast some of the pros and cons of each. And if you were to go back to the locally preferred alternative, which kept it on the other side of the road from the Krause Anderson properties, The cost would be about the same if you were to go over and then stay at grade and then go underneath Shady Oak Road. The big concern is we're getting ready to rebuild that road next year, and about 3 years down the road, the project would come through and they'd tear out that brand new road and put in a structure. And, you know, just really doesn't send a good message. It's, you know, spending a lot of money to build something to turn around a few years later and tear it up and rebuild it. So we did try to work out an agreement where, well, why don't we build it now and you could reimburse us? Federal guidelines don't allow that to happen. FTA would never agree to that. So it really wasn't on the table. Not only that, we didn't go through a full environmental, the National Environmental Protection Act requirements, because our project didn't have federal funding. Because LRT does, there's a whole different set of environmental reviews that need to be undertaken. And that, again, was another problem where they couldn't pay us for that work because we didn't go through that process. So then we looked, all right, well, maybe we don't go under. Maybe we just go over the top of it. That way we don't have to tear up the brand new road we just built. When they costed that out, it was about $10 million more. So I think when you look at those reasons, the project feels pretty strong that, you know, they've made the decision to be on the east side, or excuse me, on the west side. It's a lower cost alternative. There's less disruption to traffic during construction, because when you build a structure over, you can generally leave traffic, two-way moving traffic in place during construction. When you do a tunnel, you either have to close traffic off completely or severely restrict it. So I think if they look, when they looked at it from a construction standpoint, it was also less impactful.
What about just maintenance year over year, a tunnel versus a bridge or a bypass? Is that apples to apples as far as dollars?
Could you repeat that? I missed the beginning.
What about the maintenance issues for a tunnel versus an overhead?
Yeah, that was another thing I didn't bring up, but they do know that there are groundwater in this area. In fact, I believe there's might even be some wetlands, and they did look at that, and they generally shy away from tunnels when they know they're dealing with groundwater, because you do have pumping costs. You have, whenever you have mechanical systems, they are high maintenance type devices. I don't know that that ever played into whether or not to go with one option over the other, but I do know that they have concerns about going underground when they know there's groundwater.
So the short answer was, just to kind of sum up, it was about a $10 million difference to do plan A than it would be to go to plan B.
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
Okay, moving just a little bit farther south, this would be the second station in Eden Prairie. This is the Golden Triangle. And to familiarize the commission with where we're at, this would be the Super Value campus in this area. You've got Flying Cloud Drive over here, and then West 70th Street. This section of West 70th doesn't exist today, but it would once the project was, the LRT project was complete. We have agreements in place to have the developer extend that section of West 70th Street. The station was originally located in the docks, in the docking area on Super Value's property. They're proposing to actually move it just a little bit farther north across the street on West 70th, and then have a surface parking structure or surface parking lot located in this area. And there's also another area over here that they've identified for additional parking if needed. They kind of they looked at the Golden Triangle area as not having a need for the full build out on day one, but they know that by 2030 there's going to be a higher demand, and so they want to grow into this and preserve the ability to do joint development is one thing that they've heard from the Corridor Management Committee. Don't go build a parking structure before you know what the demand is. Why don't you wait and see what happens with joint development? Maybe there can be a partnership where you can share parking or share a site without damaging the ability to do high-density development adjacent to the station.
So, not to interrupt, I'm sorry. I know the Planning Commission, Mike, what was it, 2+ years ago when we were talking about the Super Value location, we had set aside, seemed like it was 3 or 5 acres, right, to do some sort of light rail project there and put parking and whatnot. Do you remember that?
Actually, that's correct. We had outlots set aside for the alignment, and an outlot set aside for some parking and for a light rail station.
And was that area that you were referring to, Mr. Ellis?
Okay. It is. My cursor keeps going in and out. This is an outlot that was set aside, and it is planned to be used for a surface parking lot.
And that was the original one, Mike, that we did, right?
Yes.
Okay.
It was part of Liberty Plaza.
Right. Okay.
So again, moving a little bit farther south, the next technical issue was the crossing of Nine Mile Creek. And originally the LPA called for an at-grade crossing. I think when the project office reviewed that alignment, they had some severe safety concerns with train traffic crossing at grade on a skew in that area that's heavily wooded. It's a narrow road with a big bend in it. So upon their further review, they actually recommended going with a grade separated crossing, which we think is good news because that, when we started looking at that a little bit closer, we understood their concerns. It also allows the train to go a little bit faster through this area. One of their goals is to move people from end of line to end of line as fast as possible. The slower they are, the less desirable it becomes for people to use. So they saw that as an opportunity to maintain high ridership, improve safety, and it actually resulted in fewer impacts to adjacent property owners. As you know, Eagle Ridge Academy is located right here. They're making improvements to the front of their property with their playground and bus drop-off area. Had we followed the LPA alignment, that road would have moved into their property because the project office would have needed to reconstruct that, and I don't think they would have been very happy to see that, knowing that they're making the investment today in the property. So the good news is project office has recommended a grade separated crossing going over the top of Nine Mile Creek and Flying Cloud Drive.
Yeah, Robert, before you move off the slide, maybe I'll just give a quick summary of the kind of the business impacts in this area. Most of the property owned around the station is owned by Liberty Property Trust, and they've been very much a part of the process. We've met with them many times over the last 2 years, and as you know, they've actually dedicated some property, and they've been actually very good to work with and have been very supportive of the project, including moving the station from their loading dock area a little bit north to across 70th. Shop NBC, we've met with them a couple times, and they've had some concerns too with the bridge and the alignment and the track, and how that might impact their operations. I think, as most of you know, and I know the chair for sure knows since he works there, they do TV production from that space, and so they have concerns about vibration primarily and noise. And so I think the project office is very much aware of that, and I think we'll continue to look at that particular issue and to make sure that there are no vibration issues. Whiteboard, which is just right across the way, same thing. I mean, it runs fairly close to their building and their operations. So generally supportive of the project, but just concerned, especially during construction, how that might impact their property. Liberty kind of down on the other end, and they, I don't know, I can maybe point with my pointer up here, but they also own this property up in this area. And they very much like this new alignment in that it does allow them to utilize this property that they own that's vacant today. I mean, about half of it's wet, but some of it does have potential for a parking area. And so this helps accommodate that. Plus, it kind of takes a sharper turn around. I don't know if the next slide shows that any better, but yes. Yeah, so that with that turn right there, it has less impact on their other property, which has the building right here. So
the one question I want to ask to Mr. Lindell is I know that they came in, I'm guessing the city came in, or some sort of engineering department came in, did some core samples over by Shop NBC / Shop HQ now. Yes. And they actually ran some wires into one of our studios and did a vibration test. I don't know what the results were of that test, but I know we're trying to work with the city as best we can.
I haven't seen those results either.
So.
But we'll
just an FYI, and I don't know if they're working with other businesses, but that data is probably available somewhere.
I actually wasn't aware that they had done those tests yet. Yeah, we knew they were doing soil samples.
Yeah, they
doing
did. That this was about 2 months ago, maybe.
Okay,
a month
good
and
to
a
know.
Half ago.
Well,
yeah,
we'll so let you know.
Yeah, you bet. Thanks.
Okay, moving again a little bit farther south. At this juncture, we're passing through the Liberty Trust properties. Following 212, there aren't a lot of impacts here. I think they're staying mostly within the right-of-way. Green shows at grade, so there's nothing special about that track alignment. But as they get ready to cross Valley View Road, that's where another structure would be located. And again, during the draft environmental impact statement, they were actually calling for an at-grade crossing to Valley View Road. That had a lot of people at the city a little bit nervous. You know, can that work? The trains and the cars really through that intersection? It's got a little bit of congestion, We also heard from the business owners. I think the mall was very vocal that they had serious concerns about that.
Chamber.
And the chamber as well. So that was a comment that was made through the DEIS. The project office did review this in quite detail, and they looked at it and they said, you know, there are a lot of impacts, not only to traffic, but also our run times on our train. We're going to have to stop and wait for a green light every time we go through that intersection, and that green light doesn't come very often. So they've reviewed it, and the impacts to them were too significant. They proposed doing a grade separated again. So I think that's good news from our standpoint, because we knew there were going to be some issues with traffic. So they are proposing going over the top of Valley View Road and actually over the top of Flying Cloud, and then it would land on the west side of Flying Cloud Drive. And maybe the next exhibit I have will show that a little bit better. Yes, it does. Okay. So it's coming down through here, through MnDOT right-of-way, goes up and over Valley View, over 212, and then lands on the west side of Flying Cloud Drive. And I think I have some renderings here that I can walk through. This would be a view on Flying Cloud Drive looking north. So you have the strip mall where I believe there's a veterinarian clinic located. Is it First Western Bank?
Yep.
First Western Bank is demonstrated here. And then the intersection of Flying Cloud and Valley View Drive is just up here a little bit. So as you're driving north on Flying Cloud, that's what it would look like. This is a view from the bank property, First Western Bank. If you were looking towards the intersection of Flying Cloud Drive, Valley View, there's the 7500 building, large building in the background. A view now looking towards the west on Valley View, so you're looking over towards Flying Cloud Drive, the 212 intersection right here. Structure over the top. And this would be the final rendering. This is on Valley View Road driving towards Flying Cloud Drive. This is that free right turn to go south on Flying Cloud Drive towards the mall. So that would be the structure. Pretty good visibility underneath it. It's not a big, girthy structure. Has a little bit of filled retain at the touchdown and startup of the structure, but for the most part, fairly transparent underneath it. Now, having said that, I know we've met with First Western Bank, and maybe Dave, I'll let you explain their input.
As you might imagine, they're a little bit concerned about the views from especially their second-story office, which is leased, actually, to a private separate business. You know, once he saw the 3D renderings, he got a little bit more comfortable just knowing that you can see through it. But yet it is fairly close. It doesn't actually get into their property at all. It stays in the public right-of-way, but it is, I think, about 55 feet from their building, so it's fairly close. We'd ask the project office to look at maybe some alternatives that could kind of push the bridge a little bit more out into the interchange and away from their building, and they had looked at that, but I think the issue there was that there would be piers in places where if we did want to expand that intersection and there are some longer range plans for improvements there, those would be an obstruction to those future road plans. And so that's, I think, the primary reason why we weren't really considering that that alternative. I don't know if you want to go to the next slide, but if this, or maybe go back. And then also the alignment, and I'll use my pointer up here because I can see a little bit better, but it also gets pretty close to the Hampton Inn Hotel and then also the extended stay residence inn here. It doesn't take any of their property, and it doesn't take any parking, but it's very close. And the biggest issue that CSM has, and they own this project as well as Hampton, is the noise. Are they going to be blowing their horns or ringing their bells when they go past this crossing here? Because there will be a signal here, and there may likely be gate arms coming down when the train goes by. And so that's one of the things that we're looking into, is just to get a better handle on how often those horns, or if is it bells or horns? I think we got an answer to that it might be bells there, correct? Robert.
Well, we do know it'll have gates. When they have gates, they have bells associated with those, and they also have horns. What we haven't heard is, will they use horns at this location? Sometimes if the speed's slow enough, they don't blow horns. I tend to believe that the speed through this area will be a little bit higher than what the threshold would be for horns, so I wouldn't be surprised if it'll have both. I haven't heard an official answer on that yet from the project office, though. Okay, and then as we move past the hotels, there'll be the crossing of 494. That'll simply be an expansion of the existing structure that it is there today to accommodate LRT. And then it dives into the town center area. And I've got a number of exhibits that I'll walk through here, but there was a lot of discussion about technology drive, comp plan alignment, and single tree. And maybe just to summarize how it came to be that comp plan was ultimately recommended, I think they looked at immediate impacts of traffic during construction, long-term impacts with traffic, cost, impacts to property, and ridership was another big one, economic development potential, walkability. They ran all those through a matrix, and they came up with the recommendation that comp plan was least impactful, long-term, short-term, greatest, I guess it shared the greatest potential for economic development with single tree. But I think when it ran through all of that matrix, it just came out a little bit ahead of the single tree option, and it had much more desirable impacts than the technology drive alignment. So project office did recommend that. Corridor management committee also endorsed it. And I think that's where we have landed on the town center station and alignment. Now, to walk through what the individual impacts or what this might look like through this corridor, I've got a series of exhibits. The first I'd like to point out is as you cross Technology Drive and start sweeping to the west, there's a strip mall located right here at the intersection of Eden and Flying Cloud Drive. And the project has indicated that would be a full taking. So that would be the first full taking in Eden Prairie. I know we have had a number of discussions with those property owners when we were looking at single tree alignment and this alignment. And I would generally categorize their, the nature of those conversations as just take us. If you're going to take 8 parking spaces or you're going to take all of our parking spaces, we just want to be taken. So I think, I wouldn't say that they're on board, but they see this coming. And they would feel that full taking is more desirable than a partial taking. So that is what the project will intend to do here is a full taking of that strip mall. As the alignment moves a little bit farther to the west, it's on the north side of Eden Road. Eden Road would actually get reconstructed to the south. There would be a traffic signal located at all the driveways. The first one would be here at Glen Lane. The next one would be over here at Eden Lane, where Eden Lane actually... road will have to be renamed because right now it sweeps, but there'd be another traffic signal here. And then someday if there was an extension of this road, this north-south road, likely a traffic signal there. I've got some blow-ups of each of these individual cross-sections. The first one will be right here at Discount Tire, and this would be the strip mall. There would be an impact to Discount Tire's parking. I think we can make them whole by replacing the parking on site. Again, the strip mall would be a full take. Next set of properties, we have Champs located right here. We've got Redstone over here. Redstone has an impact to a number of parking stalls. They're not made whole with the parking that would be reconstructed on site. I do know that they lose a handful of spaces. It escapes me right now how many they are.
It's a dozen, I think.
About a dozen. Yeah. I think the idea is if there's some way for them to be made whole with the property acquired at the strip mall to replace the parking, I think the city would like to pursue that with the project office because we do, we would like to see them made whole with the parking. We know that during the lunch hour and certain times of the week, it can be very busy there.
How are they overall with your meetings, Mr. Lindo?
I'm sorry.
How are they overall with the meetings that you had with them? Did you meet with them?
Redstone?
Directly? Yeah.
They've been fairly supportive. And I would say in general of the about 175 meetings I've had this year, most of the businesses have seen the project as something that could potentially benefit them long term and bring value to the real estate. However, as long as it's not taking parking or having immediate impacts during construction, and so a lot of the concerns you would expect to hear, we heard. They are concerned about 10 or 12 parking spaces. I mean, that's a big deal for them because there are times where they are completely full. But if the project does have to take that Eden Prairie Convenience Center property, there should be the potential to actually give them back some of that parking through that process. We haven't really sorted through how that works legally, It could be that the city's HRA might have to get involved at some point to help make that transaction happen. But it would be very proximate parking, so I think it'd more or less be an extension of their parking lot to the north. So.
Okay. Thank you.
And then Champs, Discount Tires, I think, is we've met with them numerous times, and they're satisfied. Their parking's whole. They see that there may be some benefits in having a signal there. Champs had concerns primarily about how that would impact their outside eating area. But at the end of the day, it doesn't really encroach into that area, but yet, obviously, the road will be closer. It will be closer, even though it's still going to be fairly high. If traffic does increase over time, you know, you might hear a little more traffic as you're sitting down there and dining. But otherwise, no impacts to their parking.
Is there an estimate that says how many trains, I guess, would be going by within an hour? Or, you know?
In an hour?
Is there a guesstimate?
I know in a day, did he say
200? Okay, tell me a day.
200 a day.
220 or so a day.
Yeah, they have peaks and...
Are there times of the day when the frequency is lower, the evening?
Yes, I do know that the number that they have used to explain frequency has been a train every 10 minutes in each direction is the frequency. So you could, they could happen at the same time, or you can't really predict that. But peak times, one every 10 minutes. They operate 22 hours a day. During the nighttime hours, it reduces. I don't know what that frequency would be, but. Train every 10 minutes during peak.
The peaks are in the morning from like 6 to 9, and in the evenings from 3 to 6.
So, okay. Thank you.
David had explained how the Champs outdoor seating area stays whole. There is a retaining wall that would be needed to kind of separate traffic from their seating area. There's a grade difference there, but they've demonstrated how that would remain whole. Moving a little bit farther west, you have the Lincoln Place Apartments. No impacts to them. There would be some acquisition of right-of-way, but their driveway coming into their underground storage remains whole, so they can still have access as they do today. And then this is that large park area located over here, owned by Emerson Rosemont. This is where a new road would be constructed, a road that doesn't exist today. Would be constructed. We're looking at on-street parking. I believe there's about 32 on-street parking stalls that are identified with the creation of that roadway. And again, we want to make this walkable, so it's got trails on both sides. We have trails separated by boulevard where possible. And you can see that right here. The water tower is located right here, so the road would skirt just north of the water tower. Again, trails on both sides, on-street parking. And we're getting close to where the new station would be located. So Town Center Station, immediately behind Brunswick Zone. It's identified right here. This would terminate in a cul-de-sac, at least for the time being. Access in and out of the site by vehicle would be east-west on Eden Road. They are identifying trails coming from Singletree up towards this station through the parking lot that exists today at Brunswick Zone. And one thing that, if you've been back there, there's a big hill. I mean, you can't see Emerson Rosemont when you're in the Brunswick parking lot. There is a large hill. One positive thing that could happen with this project is a lot of that soil would be removed to get this track to the grade that it needs to be and for the construction of that roadway. I think it'll bring those two areas together. Right now, they're geographically separated. You can't really get there from here. This project would eliminate a lot of that obstruction from that part of the Town Center properties. So that is something that would be planned with the project. And you can see right here, the dashed line is the existing grade. So that's a good 10, 15, 20 foot drop in elevation that you would see after the project.
Yeah, there'll be a dramatic difference when you're between Old Chicago and Brunswick looking north. I mean, you'll be able to see now basically all the way over towards Gander Mountain. And that's important because you need to see the station and know that it exists. We had a lot of conversations about whether or not we were going to need to make a connection with this north-south road between Singletree and Technology Drive. And I think, as you probably know, that's been on our comprehensive plan for many years to eventually make that connection. And we really thought that connection needed to be made as part of this project. But The biggest challenge we have in making the connection primarily from Singletree North is that it would take almost 50 or 60 spaces from Brunswick. And we have nowhere to replace those spaces. And that's the conundrum that's really kind of forced us to just delay that project until sometime in the future when maybe they'll consider redeveloping their site. So in the meantime, we did find a way to make a trail connection so that pedestrians walking on Singletree or coming out of the apartments can walk through that area and easily access the new station. I don't know if you had a graphic of that or not, but...
Maybe the best one.
Yeah, that's probably the best one here. So kind of going back up with the pointer here. So the new trail would kind of come up and kind of skirt the west side of the building and then eventually make its way right up to the station platform right here. And then for those that aren't familiar with the future road, the city would eventually like to make a connection from Singletree all the way up to Technology Drive. In fact, we obtained an easement from Rosemont Emerson a number of years ago, and that's kind of what's shown here for a future roadway.
Okay, and then the final exhibit I have for this town center station would be the water tower apartments. Just what would the impact be to their property? And again, they do have they have a driveway over here for underground parking. I think they might even have trash bin receptacles in this area. That would all remain. There would be a possibly a retaining wall here, or it might just be graded back. So there wouldn't be any impact to their property and how it functions today. So from this area, we're coming out of town center. Now we're moving towards the Southwest Station. And to get there from here, they start coming down that hill. It's about a 60-foot grade elevation as you're coming from the backside of Costco down towards Prairie Center Drive. They are trying to miss those two detention ponds that are located up back there. It might be some type of a land bridge or some type of a structure there. But as they come over the top of Prairie Center Drive, certainly that will be a structure. So it would come over Prairie Center Drive. It would land on the west side of Prairie Center Drive. It would stay above ground along Purgatory Park. It stays within the right-of-way, and it crosses over the top of Technology Drive. And then it actually starts coming down and lands at grade on the backside of Southwest Station. And I do have some renderings to show what that would look like as well. The first one here, this would be along Prairie Center Drive. I think this is at Technology Drive, so standing underneath the structure itself at that signalized intersection, looking towards the south. This would be the large pavilion in Purgatory Park. This would be the flagship building. This would be the 800 building located here. I think that's Costco on top of the hill. Next rendering, this would be in the park looking out towards the intersection of Prairie Center Drive Technology. That would be the structure that's coming off of the backside of Costco, running alongside Prairie Center Drive over the top of Technology and into Southwest Station.
Is this the longest overpass that we have in this?
In Eden Prairie, it would be. I'm not certain that it's the longest structure on the project.
But in Eden Prairie, it is. Okay.
Yes. This would be looking on Prairie Center Drive on the, it would be the east side of Prairie Center Drive looking north up to the Highway 212 interchange in this direction. We've got Southwest Station here. This is the pavilion in Purgatory Park. And I believe my last rendering, this would be on the east side of Prairie Center Drive looking into the park. Okay, so getting through that area and then into the Southwest Station, here's where we still have a lot of question marks. Exactly what does that look like? And right now, Met Council and Southwest Station are trying to determine if they can indeed coexist. I think our perspective, and even through the LPA, there was always a station planned here. We just want to make sure that both survive. I mean, Southwest Transit is a very good partner of City of Eden Prairie and Chaska and Chanhazen. We very much like the services they provide. We want them to be here long term, but we also see the value of LRT, and we'd like to see some way for these two to co-locate. We think at the end of the day that's best for the customer. But a lot of those details need to be fleshed out. Those two organizations need to sit down together and see if they can manage the issues that will come up with a co-location alternative.
Do they, I'm sorry to interrupt, do they see themselves as competing against one another? I mean, I would assume they would, but do they?
Yes. I mean, they provide a similar service, although the express bus is a direct trip downtown, so it's pretty fast, whereas the LRT is going to have multiple stops along the way. The advantage we think it brings would be people could have a choice of using both on the same day. I mean, you could take the bus downtown and find out you need to come back at 11 a.m. and the bus isn't running, and the trains are running more frequently all day. And so even though they have similar patterns in that they're taking people from Eden Prairie in this area downtown, the LRT obviously has greater potential for taking people from Minneapolis and the other suburbs it passes through and bringing those workers out to Eden Prairie. So we think the potential for the reverse commute is going to be great for the LRT. But there's a lot of operational issues that need to be worked out. And you may know that Southwest Transit had gone to the three cities and they had asked the cities to pass a resolution which had four primary conditions which would need to be met for them to be able to coexist with Metro Transit. And they kind of had to do with branding and protecting their service area, you know, being able to want to continue to provide the exclusive provider of express service in this region. I don't know, what was the fourth?
They wanted to ensure that the parking calculations were agreeable on both sides. What is the need here at this station? The last thing they want to have is not enough parking spaces for the number of customers that want to use it. And 169, I think another one was Southwest Transit sees a need for a market to be served on 169 corridor, and they want to be a part of that. So they had asked that whether that's Metro Transit long-term going beyond the service area Southwest Transit serves, they would want to have a role if there is a station located in Eden Prairie. So I think those four conditions need to be worked out by those two organizations. We're hopeful that they can all come to an agreement, because we do see the value for the customer in having additional options, more choices, more flexibility when they're going, whether it's Minneapolis, St. Louis Park, Hopkins, or wherever it might be. We see that there's a benefit.
I was going to ask a slightly different version of that question, and that was how threatened Southwest might feel by this. And it would seem to me one of the considerations is how much incremental traffic or ridership is being created by the light rail compared to the amount of ridership that Southwest has today. So if it's just dividing up the same pie in different ways, that might hurt Southwest.
Mm-hmm.
It would seem to me it'd be pretty critical that you have incremental ridership generated because of the different structure of the two kinds of services. Otherwise, you're just dividing up the same pie into smaller parts.
Mm-hmm.
And that would hurt Southwest, I would think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And, so.
Yeah. Well, maybe I'll dive into the numbers, and the numbers might help answer that question. So currently Southwest Transit has 925 parking spaces in their structure located on site. LRT is proposing adding another 1,000. They see the demand for an additional 1,000 there. So I think for them to make that kind of an investment without banking on those riders being there, they must feel pretty serious that there's a demand for
sure
that
would
many.
Imply incremental ridership. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes. But with 200 trains a day, which was a surprising number in terms of frequency, in my opinion, boy, you can catch a ride pretty much anytime you
yes.
want.
Yep.
Every,
that's the idea.
Especially during peak hours, and I would think Southwest would be a little threatened by that. But
well, one point I should make too is that originally, with the line running all the way to Mitchell and this being the final station over here at City Center, and maybe Robert will talk more about that, but now that they've eliminated that station, that plan was to have about 900 spaces. That demand still exists, so that's why they're moving so much parking to Southwest Station, and it's becoming, you know, very crowded with parking for sure. Originally, I think they planned about 400 spaces at Southwest Station, additional parking spaces to accommodate LRT, but under the current scenario with Southwest being the fourth and final station, they're looking at adding a total of over 1,200 parking spaces.
And how many are there right now at Southwest?
925.
You know, it gets to, and this is nothing but a general issue, obviously, but it gets to the issue which I've been curious about over a period of time, and that is, for the city of Eden Prairie, what does an LRT win look like someday? In other words, based on the criteria that the city would like to see accomplished with an LRT system, not talking about Met Council yet or anything like that, but the city of Eden Prairie, what does a win look like eventually for LRT? And it's an interesting question to ask because it starts to push toward what are the criteria for the city for this to be successful? How does it impact Southwest and so on?
Yeah, there's probably different answers to that. I think one of the things we kind of hit on in our last presentation was that we really wanted to get the alignment in an area that would be used and that would benefit our employment areas. And as you know, the original alignment that was considered years ago would be bringing it basically down the existing right-of-way that Hennepin County owns through our residential areas, and it would completely miss our business parks by about 3 or 4 miles. So the fact that and everybody recognized that right away, that just really didn't make sense to have it over there. So that very much in my mind is a win, that I think we have the alignment in the right place. Then it was getting the stations in the proper location so that they could be used not only by people that want to park and get on the train and go downtown, but for people to be able to come out to Eden Prairie, get off the train, and at least have the potential to be able to walk to their work. But you know, practically speaking, people aren't going to walk probably more than 5 or 10 minutes, especially in the middle of January.
But
so
that's right.
there's going to be a need for some kind of a shuttle service or a circulator service that would run frequently, I think, during those peak times, like through the Golden Triangle area, so that folks could get off the train and still quickly get to the front door of their business. And some businesses might provide that privately. You know, if they have enough of their employees that need or want that service, they could certainly step up and provide that themselves. So the station, the alignment, the station locations, I think, have been critical. Robert, I think, is very pleased that most of the crossings are grade separated, so the impacts to our local traffic operations are pretty minimal. We are very concerned, as you mentioned, at the Valley View Road crossing there, which is a very the volumes are very high in that area. So at the end of the day, I think all of the crossings are grade separated except for Technology Drive over by not Fuddruckers. What's the pancake?
IHOP.
Yeah. Right by IHOP there. So that will be a grade crossing, an at grade crossing there. But so, I mean, those are a few thoughts about what might make it a win for Eden Prairie.
You know, I think they're talking 30 to 34,000 rides a day, and our transportation system can't handle that. So, you know, what I'm looking as a public works director, the more people I can get off the road and get on a train and make it convenient for them where they want to do that. And when you look at those 30,000 rides, the vast majority are in Eden Prairie. They want to get on here, and they want to go downtown. They want to go to St. Paul. They want to go to University of Minnesota. This doesn't just end in Minneapolis. I mean, it does serve the St. Paul area as well. So as convenient as we can make it to get those riders off the system and onto an LRT, I think that's critical. Mm-hmm. And that's one of the unanswered questions right now is they've talked about eliminating the Mitchell Road station. That makes it less desirable for that person living in Chasco or Eden Prairie that wants to get on and take a ride down. It's forcing everybody to this station because if you haven't heard in the news, this is now the proposed end-of-line station. So I think one thing that we are still advocating for and still trying to negotiate into this project is getting that final fifth station at Mitchell Road. And I see that as something that's critical to the success of not only LRT, but we got highways out there that we're just going to see more and more users on 212 and 5. And we can get those people off and get them on LRT. It's going to help everybody. So.
Just quickly building on that, and then we'll move on. And I very much appreciate this very thorough review. Do you see most of the traffic emanating from Eden Prairie, or are you thinking it's going to be basically a mix of traffic emanating from the city and then people coming from all over the metro into Eden Prairie? In other words, the incremental traffic that might not have been there before.
Yeah, 212 and 5, we've seen the route diagrams. Where are these riders coming from? I mean, there's a lot from Eden Prairie, but when you look at the flow diagrams, Highway 212 and Highway 5 are bringing a lot of cars in. So you are serving Chanhas and Chaska, those commuters that are coming through this area already. But there's a lot of Eden Prairie riders, too. But those are the two main corridors that these people are coming to the Parker rides for.
So one question on that too, Mr. Lindahl, as you met with some of the business owners and some other people, how do you sell this as far as, I mean, do you have any estimates that saying, hey, people are going to be coming to Eden Prairie, they're going to be spending money, they're going to be eating at your restaurants, they're going to be spending their money at the mall? I mean, what kind of impact is that?
All of that.
Okay.
You know, I think anytime you have the ability to move more people in and out of your community, it potentially brings benefit to businesses, you know, whether it's their employees or whether it's customers. The retailers, especially the Eden Prairie Center, you know, they weren't sure how many customers might take the train and come out and shop. We felt that people would probably want to come out and go to the movies or go to the, you know, and eat at the restaurants or whatever, and kind of that entertainment draw, especially if you want to have a glass of wine and not have to drive home, you could take the train home. But most of the businesses, except for the auto-based businesses like Bobby and Steve's and some of those places, they didn't really see how the rail could benefit them other than the potential for an employee to be coming from Minneapolis or Hopkins or St. Louis Park and coming out to their site.
I think that over time will be an interesting thing to try and understand, and you probably already have a much better understanding than I do, but that is, how does, if LRT is going to grow business, how specifically does it accomplish that over time? Is it more trial of business here because you bring in incremental people? Is it more repeat business, whatever it is? And we don't need to get into that now, but it'll just be interesting to understand over time if that payout is occurring for the city or return on investment is occurring for the city, even though the city doesn't directly invest in mm-hmm. this.
Yeah. Okay, so I don't have a lot to report on Southwest Transit as far as what this would look like if the two parties can agree. What we have done, though, is we've looked at the traffic because there's been a lot of concern about, can this area house this much traffic? And it looks like it can be done. It's not the best scenario that we could end up with, but from a technical standpoint, I guess the engineers could say, yes, it would work. And to help you understand what's being proposed, and this is almost a worst-case scenario, meaning worst being this is the most traffic we could put at the site. Now, if we can negotiate this fifth station along Mitchell Road, the parking demand at this location goes down, so it would only get better from a traffic standpoint. But if we don't, then this is what they're proposing to build. So existing 925 spaces being utilized by bus rapid transit or express service. They're proposing 1,025 spaces for LRT. Now you'll hear the number 1,225 being constructed. That extra 200 is because they're replacing what exists today for those businesses, because it would displace a number of surface lots. So they need 1,025. They're building 1,225 because they need to give those 200 back to the businesses.
But that right there, it takes out some restaurants and a bank and whatnot, right?
Yeah, so this would be the second and third full taking. Anchor Bank has always been identified as a property that would need to be acquired with the project, regardless of what option is chosen. But what's new is we're showing Ruby Tuesday on the map now, too. So to accommodate that full, you know, 1,200 parking spaces, it would, at least this layout would require the acquisition of that property. Now, getting in and out of the site is the technical difficulty. Right now, you have one full access with a signal coming in. It serves the 925 plus all the businesses. They also have a right in, right out right here. This has been identified as an intersection that would need to have full access to serve these properties. Now, currently, this is the bus station waiting area. The Southwest Transit offices are located right here. One thing that's been discussed is, well, maybe you could put that station right here, the parking over the top of that. Have first floor, or maybe the first two floors would be where the station is located, bathrooms, a lobby area enclosed, and then parking above that. I think technically it can be done. It would also help distribute the traffic more evenly to these two access points, which we think would be a benefit to the site. Putting the main egress
into the site at this location and put, my opinion, too much pressure on that one access point.
I might add, Robert, quickly, too, that this plan where you put all 1,000-plus spaces on the east side, is there's major concern from the other businesses in the area, not just Ruby Tuesdays. Ruby's actually is kind of, if you're going to impact us, even if you're going to bring the parking up close to us, take us. We'd rather be gone. But Santorini's, the strip of restaurants in front, and Culver's are all very concerned primarily about the size of that ramp and how it would obstruct people's views as you get off the ramp and come down Prairie Center Drive. Today you can look down and you can see the restaurant, you can see Santorini's, you can see start to see the strip of restaurants that are on the south side of the current ramp, and that would all be blocked. And so they're very concerned. So when Robert talks about trying to better utilize the west side, they very much support that idea. Plus they're concerned about the impacts during construction. So if you're going to build that ramp, you know, over in their current parking area, what happens to those display spaces that their customers use? So those are two of the many issues that they've brought up as we've met with them in the last couple of weeks over this particular plan.
So what do those intersections operate at under 2030 build and no build scenario? So when we program out all the development, redevelopment that we expect on Prairie Center Drive, and you look at the morning peak hour, no build, it operates under acceptable level of service, D's and better. When you look at 2030 in the morning under a build scenario, so again, that would be 1,000 new park and ride for LRT and then maintain bus as is, it gets a little bit worse, but generally acceptable level of service, D and better. So morning's not a big deal. PM's a different story. When you look at 2030 PM no build, we got some Fs. We've got problems. So we've identified the fact that we need to make improvements with or without LRT just because of that PM peak hour for existing development that we have in our comp plan. So no surprise, you go to 2030 PM with the build, it just gets a little bit worse. You get one more F. So project office has identified that if we are indeed going to build this, we've got improvements that we're going to have to mitigate to make this a workable site. So what they're proposing is Prairie Center Drive gets a third lane in each direction, northbound, southbound, and then there's some intersection improvements at the 212 off-ramp and then also at possibly Technology Drive. So they've demonstrated that they could mitigate that traffic, those traffic impacts, and give us a level of service D. But what they've admitted is that 212 is a mess. There's nothing we can do about that. So we can get them to the interchange. Whether or not they can get on it, that's another story. So that's why we've advocated move it farther west, get down to allow people to use Wallace Road. You've seen how underutilized that ramp is. Let the Highway 5 people use the Mitchell Road interchange. So you can split that traffic up from those two intersections, and you're not forcing all this traffic to come down here. So I think our question is, yeah, you can make the local road system work, but they're not going to be able to get on to 212 and 5 because it's jammed. They can't get on the interstate. So move it farther west. They say that's another story. We can show that it can work on your network. And that's all we need to do is mitigate those impacts. So we also had them take a look at Mitchell Road, Wallace Road, what happens AM and PM, build, no build, knowing that we will have increased traffic at those intersections. What does it do to our system? I guess to summarize this is everything's acceptable today. It will be in 2030 with LRT or without it. And these numbers tend to make sense to me. I believe that. I think our real problems are Mitchell and then 212. How do they get on 212 at that intersection? It's a very congested area. So they may or they may not continue with analyzing a fifth station all the way out to Mitchell Station area. And I say may or may not because if it's not officially included in the project, FTA may not allow that design to go forward. The city has advocated, and CMC, the Corridor Management Committee, has actually endorsed keeping this on the table, at least through design. You don't have to commit to building it, but maybe if contingency funds become available, project costs go down, for whatever reason, if at the end of the day there is a little bit of money, that we've got a set of plans, we know that from an environmental standpoint, it's got the clearances so that it could be added to the project. So that still has to play out yet. We don't have a definitive answer from the project office whether or not they can do that and satisfy FTA requirements.
So what would be the cost of being able to do that? I mean, when they're looking at the pros and cons and specifically the dollars amounts with that, what's the cost in doing that Mitchell Station and building it out for them?
Well, the cost that they have reported would be $80 million, $75 to $80 million to construct it out to the Mitchell Station, wherever that station is. So, I mean, it was it's an obvious cut when your project's over budget. And we know everything that's going on with freight rail and that. And it was a major cost to the project that wasn't planned. So we saw this coming a long time ago. But I guess we're still trying to keep this on the table in some form or fashion should funds become available. So, but $80 million is what they claim it would save by eliminating that final station and the alignment. And, you know, that number sounds right to me. It's about, from a planning purpose, $80 million a mile is what they've used to forecast what the cost of this would be. Well, this is a little over a mile, so that makes sense. It's probably very close to that number.
I'm a little out of date, and I haven't heard, has a decision been made on where the maintenance facility will be located? And I'm assuming probably not in Eden Prairie.
Not in Eden Prairie. That decision hasn't officially been made, but the Corridor Management Committee did endorse having that located in Hopkins. So,
I have a question on the Mitchell Station. Have they estimated how many riders they might lose by eliminating that station?
They have. You know, honestly, the number escapes me right now, but they do show a loss in ridership, but something that I think that they feel that they could live without to keep this within the budget that they're trying to achieve.
Would be at least 900. That was the size of the ramp that they had planned.
So I will walk through this design just so the commission has an idea of what this final alignment and station would look like. What we have looked at is Technology Drive. So coming out of Southwest Station, new traffic signal at Technology Drive. It would be on the south side of Technology Drive. It would cross Purgatory Creek here. Again, it's staying outside of the roadway, passes next to the Optum campus, new traffic signal located here. Generally, whenever the train crosses a major intersection or a major driveway, they have to signalize it. Again, the second access point into Optum's campus would be right here. There would be a new traffic signal located there. It would cross Mitchell Road at grade. They would need to make some improvements to the roadway at this intersection and also to the intersection slightly to the north to make this make the traffic work in conjunction with LRT. And they've shown some decrease in level of service, and they can mitigate most of that by making these improvements. And then crossing over towards City Center, so we're located here in this building, and then plans for a park and ride, 900 parking spaces located here, 4 to 5 stories tall. I didn't really get into the details there, but rather significant end of line structure located on the west side of our property with the station platform located in this area.
Maybe just a little history on that, because I think the last presentation you saw that it ran all the way down by Wallace Road, mm-hmm. and that it was the station was integrated with a park and ride and the operations and maintenance facility. There's a lot happening, and it was going to take out our public works facility, mm-hmm. Two buildings on Wallace Road, the Metro Machines, and then also some of Eaton's property. Once the Metro Transit operations people looked at the difference between an Eden Prairie, OMF, and Hopkins, they realized that it would cost them about an additional $500,000 a year in operating costs for that additional length of track to run every day with people. And so that's what kind of led them to go to Hopkins. Once that happened, we thought, well, why do we really need to be down at Wallace Road? We started looking at alternatives, and that's when we kind of landed at the City Center. We thought, you know, we have a fairly large parking field out there that's right now used by the education center. If we could maintain that parking and go up, you know, maybe we could provide that at potentially no cost to the project, and then locate the station just on the south side of of technology and eliminate all the impacts to Eaton and to our public works facility, which, by the way, we hadn't really identified another place to rebuild that, and to the other businesses on Wallace. So we were really feeling like this was a good plan, and I don't recall the number. At one time, they thought it was going to save up to $15 million just to eliminate that short stretch from Wallace to the city center. I think they revised that to be a little bit less than $15 million at the end of the day. But so this is still a plan that I think we very much support for all the reasons you kind of heard tonight. It kind of balances things out better from a traffic standpoint. If you, instead of kind of trying to cram all those potatoes into one small sack at Southwest Station, you know, to spread it out a little bit more. But as Robert alluded to, the freight rail conundrum is costing the project up to an additional $150 million, and that's right now they're looking at doing two shallow tunnels through the Kenilworth corridor, and they're looking for places to save money, and I would call this, I guess, the low-hanging fruit. You know, Eden Prairie, cut it off, cut the tail off by a mile, and we'll save $80 million. We're still very disappointed with that decision, and we haven't really given up on it. And so I think you might be hearing our mayor and others speaking about what they can do to try to get that back into the project over the next few months, since the project has been delayed, or decision has been delayed by about 3 months, as they further analyze the shallow tunnel options. You know, Minneapolis does still have some concerns about that, so that might give us a little bit more time to politically kind of work this section of the project back into the project.
Do we have some leverage to be able to do that, do you believe?
Potentially. I'm not sure if I could articulate just exactly what that is.
Okay, but
other than everything that we told you tonight makes sense to most people.
Right.
There's a potential loss in ridership. There's much more impact to a very sensitive area of Eden Prairie where traffic is already pretty bad, and it's going to be bad either way. You know, $80 million is a lot of money, but you know, compared to the entire project, I have to be careful when I say that, because that is a lot of money, but this is still a $1.5 billion project. And, you know, a lot of ridership is being derived from this area in Eden Prairie.
Sure.
And Eden Prairie's got the highest ridership and also the highest parking demand with all of our stations compared to any of the other communities. So
I have to ask you, just because you're so close to the project and you've been in a lot of different groups, I know that nobody has a crystal ball, but with federal deficits and all the other sorts of things being faced, what do you think the likelihood, do you have any insight on the likelihood that this will get fully funded and actually occur? I know this is a very detailed planning period, but I'm just curious if you have any instinct on that or...
I mean, I think we have to take our cue from the project office staff, and this is their third project now after Hiawatha and the Minneapolis-St. Paul. And they're feeling pretty confident that this project ranks very well and competes well with the rest of the country now. They can't predict either what could happen at the federal level. And I think there's maybe a little bit more concern that the local funding partners, you know, stay committed to their portion of the project. I think the CTIB, the County Transportation Improvement Board, they're proposed to pay 30% of the total project cost. They're very much concerned about the budget going up and up and up, and they're the group that's been pretty vocal about trying to kind of hold the line at about $1.5 billion. And I think that message, I think at the end of the day, kind of resulted in them looking at Eden Prairie and saying this is a place where we could save some money. But the state is expected to pay for 10% of the total project cost. They haven't absolutely committed that entire amount. They've committed, I think, about $80 million, and they still need about another, I think their total was about 150.
Yeah, they're about halfway there.
Yeah, and so the County Rail Authority, I think, has committed. So federal, who knows for sure? I think the history has been that the FTA has been pretty supportive of these projects, and they've come through. So I would hope they do the same.
And my last question on that subject, just looking out into the future, the final go, no-go decision in terms of funding and, okay, now let's execute, let's do it. When is that projected to just roughly occur?
There's actually a number of steps that will have to happen before we get a full funded grant agreement. That's when everybody, all agencies that are funding the project, FTAA, it's past environmentals, everybody signs the agreement that says this project will move forward. They're predicting sometime 2014, 2015 before that would actually happen, so it's out there a ways. Before we get to that point, there's a number of local approvals that have to happen. And it starts with the five cities and Hennepin County all have to agree to the municipal consent plans. And that'll be the plans that the project office delivers to the five cities in the county saying, this is what we're going to build. And they're gonna ask each city in the county to agree to that project. So not that they have to get all of those approvals, but I think to keep the project on track and ensure that we're all in support of this project, they'd like to get a yes vote from everybody. Once that process has happened, they will actually go to the FTA and they will have their project rated. This is a good project, bad project. They've got a number of things that they look at, from ridership to cost, economic development potential. All of these things will help give the project a rating. Once it's been rated, then they put it up against all the other projects in the country and how they're rated, and that's when they determine which ones move forward. Then you'll have to have the financial commitments from Hennepin County, the state, and from CTIB. And I think once all of those things fall in place, that's where everybody signs on the dotted line. And again, that would be late 14, probably 2015. I wouldn't be surprised mid 2015 before that's done.
So thank you very much.
Got a little bit of work still.
Yeah, I would say so.
So one question from, I guess, from a citizen, Eden Prairie, do they ever get a chance to vote on this, or is it just mainly discussions? Even if the city council came back and said, I don't like the plan, we don't agree with the plan, we're not going to say yes. Basically, the Met Council and Hennepin County, as long as that funding's there, could come in and do it anyways. Is that accurate?
They could. They do not necessarily need a affirmative vote from the city council on the municipal consent plans to move this project forward. I would say if you look at Hiawatha and Central, they've always secured that before they felt comfortable enough to move it forward. This is probably the most charged project they've had, though, so it's a little bit different. Mm-hmm. But to answer your question, would there be a public vote? Not necessarily on the project. Ultimately, Met Council will make the decision of whether or not to move forward with this project.
So but how does a... Oh, go ahead.
Oh, I was just going to say quickly, I will say that now that I've had about 9 months of experience and working on this project pretty intensely with them, that they've been working hard to try to come up with a plan that we're happy with. We as a community, you know, that has the greatest benefit and the least impacts. And I think they've overall done a pretty good job, and they've been listening. I mean, we meet weekly at these issue resolution team meetings, and we would, you know, I'd bring back one of the first things we do at these meetings. They'd say, Dave, who have you met with and what have they said? And that would get factored into the planning on different alignments. So I think they're working hard with all five cities to come up with an alignment, station locations that everybody's happy with, so that they do get municipal consent. Because like Robert said, they always have.
It doesn't sound like this is really affecting any homeowners per se, right? It's all...
Well, potentially the Southwest condos. If it extended west of Southwest Station, okay, and if it stayed on the north alignment,
okay,
the LPA alignment, it gets very close to those condos. But otherwise, even though it does get, it's in the same neighborhood as the bluffs at Nine Mile Creek, it's not real close.
Okay. And I'm sure it's been well established that if citizens of Eden Prairie have any concerns or whatever, that there's a process they can go through in order to voice those concerns?
Absolutely. And the municipal consent process is really meant for that to be an opportunity for the residents of Eden Prairie to show up. There will be a hearing, and it'll be really dedicated for people to give up and give testimony about their feelings on the project. We haven't set a date for that yet. We had a date set, but now the entire thing's been delayed by a few months. But I'm guessing probably early next year, maybe in January, or maybe February, the council would, do we still think we might meet in December?
No.
Yeah, probably be early next year, where we'd set a meeting and be dedicated just to hearing people and their views. And then at probably a subsequent council meeting, they would make a decision on whether or not they accept the municipal consent plans.
So would there be any action, I guess, Mike, that would come back to this commission or any kind of council commission recommendation at all? Or how do you see this playing out as far as this commission goes?
Actually, the only vote on the project comes from the City Council as part of municipal consent after they hold the public hearing. If you have some viewpoints or perspectives about what you heard that you want to pass on to the City Council, we certainly can do that for you.
But there would not be, our commission would not need to weigh in necessarily on anything.
No. In this case, the Planning Commission is not advisory to the City Council.
Right.
As they would be on our comprehensive plan or projects that you typically see.
Understood.
I think, and I've always kind of felt this way, but I haven't been closely associated with the project, and you folks have brought up some issues in this area that have been very helpful. To me, the thing that would be really nice to clarify for the City of Eden Prairie is the business proposition here, or the community proposition, if I could put it that way. So it's really a matter of saying, what are the benefits that we as a community truly believe in that this is going to bring to the community? And that's the thing I would be interested in just seeing. And I think based on what you've been saying tonight, you have a lot of ideas there. You talked about a matrix in which various criteria were applied and things like that. But I think it's almost like it has two dimensions. One would be the and you've done quite a job with that tonight, the engineering, the routing, and all of that sort of stuff, all of the pragmatic considerations. But then there's also the consideration of, for the city, for the citizens, and so on, what's the concept overall of benefit, if I could put it that way? And I'm not saying there's any doubt there, just saying that would be nice as part of the story to have in hand for folks in Eden Prairie.
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Ellis. Do you have any closing remarks or statements? I know we've been asking questions along the way.
No, I think we ended up kind of doing my closing statements, next steps. The next step really is there's another 60 to 90 days of analysis that we can expect for the project office to complete related to freight rail. Once those decisions have been made, I suspect the Corridor Management Committee will once again make a recommendation to Met Council. Met Council will then take action to approve the municipal consent plans. That will be followed no less than 30 days after that Met Council vote. Met Council and HCRA, Hennepin County Regional Rail Authority, will hold a public hearing. That will start this countdown that's identified in state statutes, where we have four cities and the county have 45 days from that point to either approve or deny the municipal consent plans. When you look at that protracted timeline, I'm guessing sometime February, maybe March, before that will happen. So there will be opportunities for further input from the public before a decision is made, but we do have a little bit of breathing room. This was all expected to happen in November and December, and so it did give us a little bit more time to study some of these issues that we don't have answers yet on. Mitchell Station's a big question mark.
Well, so. I'm sure everybody feels this way. We'd like to very much thank you for all of the work that you put into this, you and your teams, and the very detailed review. I thought it was excellent, so
thank you.
I agree. Commissioners, do you have any other questions before we move on at all? Is everybody okay? Okay. Mr. Ellis, Mr. Lindahl, thank you for your time. I appreciate it. Thank you for keeping this commission up to speed on light rail. I appreciate that. Yes. With that, Mike, do you have anything to add before we move off of planner's reports?
I have nothing relevant to add.
Okay. Are there any members' reports at all? Okay. Any continuing business? Any new business? If not, I will entertain a motion for adjournment.
So moved.
Motion. Second. And a second. All in favor say aye.
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 Meeting is adjourned. Thank you very much.